This election season in North Carolina, who gets to vote may be as important as who they vote for. Now, over 55,000 North Carolinians who are serving a felony conviction but out of prison will be able to cast a vote, regardless of parole or probation status. The restoration of that right comes after a three-year-long legal fight. That's because in 2019, Forward Justice, a non-partisan organization dedicated to advancing racial, social, and economic justice in the South, helped file a lawsuit over a North Carolina law called NCGS 13-1. A little background. Under North Carolina's constitution, the right to vote is restricted for those convicted of felonies, but also says the right to vote should be restored in a manner prescribed by law, specifically NCGS 13-1. The lawsuit argued that the law unconstitutionally tied the restoration of voting rights to the completion of parole, probation, or other supervisory sentences, and payment of all outstanding court fines. The law disproportionately affected Black citizens, they said, and effectively tied the right to vote to the ability to pay. This April, after a series of twists and turns, a North Carolina Court of Appeals upheld a trial court order, ruling that the law was, in fact, unconstitutional. Daryl Atkinson is the co-director of Forward Justice and the lead attorney on the case.
The original intent of this law, when it was passed in 1877 after the passage of the first constitutional amendment on felony disenfranchisement in the history of North Carolina, the original intent was that to suppress the political power of Black people, because it was shortly after the passage of the 15th Amendment, which gave Black men the right to vote.
Previously, those directly impacted would be prohibited from voting until all post-release requirements were met, which was frequently extended by unpaid court fees. But this legal fight is still not over. Those impacted have gained the right to vote in the 2022 midterm elections and all other future elections for now, by a stay of a previous court order. But the North Carolina Supreme Court will then hear the case in 2023. But one thing Atkinson says has been certain is who has been able to vote has had a real impact on who's been elected to lead North Carolina.
Our governor's race was decided by 12,000 votes, 56,000 people disenfranchised. Our Supreme Court justice race, most recently, was decided by 401 votes, 56,000 people could not participate.
Lawyers for the state argued that since the law did provide a path to the restoration of rights, once all sentences were completed and fines paid, the law did not in fact disenfranchise North Carolinians. But Forward Justice argues the provision had a racist intent, and by putting up financial barriers, it did disenfranchise people, specifically people of color. And in North Carolina, like the rest of the United States, disenfranchisement disproportionately affects Black Americans.
African Americans represent 21% of the voting age population. They're 42% of the people who are disenfranchised. For example, in Mecklenburg County, the rate is 7-1.
And that trend is consistent statewide. In Wake County, which includes the capital city of Raleigh, the rate is 6-1. In Orange County, the home to UNC Chapel Hill, the rate is over 7-1. And he adds, that has not been by accident.
We know that the laws and policies that have been in place have not been racially neutral. Take, for example, we had for many, many years, decades, where 101 crack to powder cocaine disparity. That's what results in more people getting felonies. Hypersegregation, because of FHA redlining, where African-American communities are clustered into certain areas. So these things are not by happenstance. This is a well-documented history, and North Carolina is not an exception to that history.
So with the right to vote restored for those formerly incarcerated with felony convictions, advocates had to work to register voters and spread the word that it was now legal to vote ahead of the November midterms. Jarvis Johnson is a campaign data and field manager for Forward Justice.
Voter registration, GOTV, it's hard. It's not an easy thing to do. then when you're talking to individuals that are directly impacted by the criminal justice system and they're hurt, you know, as gracious as the state is in letting individuals know that they're not being able to vote, you know, it would be just as gracious if they would let those individuals know that they could vote.
Atkinson argues that the state of North Carolina has not done enough to get information out about the registration process to those who have just re-earned the right to vote.
We're explaining them the process that you do have to re-register because now you are removed from the roll and you had received this letter and they're confused about what they're supposed to do next. So in this abdication of state responsibility to let voters know what they need to know so they can really engage in the process, we've had to step in the gap.
To overcome that confusion, a group of organizations launched a statewide effort over the summer to get the word out.
And a lot of these individuals, like I said earlier, you know, they're hurt already by this system, by being impacted by the system. They don't believe in the system.
To try to overcome the systemic distrust with voters built by a system that had penalized and disenfranchised them, Forward Justice used a personalized campaign, connecting with individuals to reinforce the importance of the vote.
We have to have directly impacted people that are just like these individuals, having those conversations with them, you know, making them into believers about democracy, because everyone deserves the right to vote. Once we've gotten someone on the phone that agrees to actually go and register, we'll take out the time to, hey, you know, if you got a second, can you go to the site right now? And we'll actually walk them through that process of registering.
Atkinson says these newly reinstated voters are a necessary part of the democratic process.
I really highlight that justice is on the ballot. Sheriffs, district attorneys, judges at all levels of our court, including the Supreme Court, state legislatures who make laws related to the criminal legal system, all of that is on the ballot. And what a mighty fine way irony is sometimes, the very people who've been targeted, who've been maligned, who've been outcast, now they have the opportunity, the tables have turned, that they have the opportunity to scrutinize the record of those decision makers to decide if they want or are suitable for the job.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Tim McPhillips.